I welcome you all for this webinar. So among us, among the participants, there are many distinguished personalities. I would like to take their names. Among them are today's chief guest, Dr. Mamta Padole, today's speaker of the webinar, Dr. Manish Tibrewal. We have with us Professor Bhatia, a governing council member from IIT Center Bangalore. Dr. Kasat, governing council member. Dr. Ajay Thakre, he is also governing council member. Dr. Pradeep Javandia, who is ex-vice chairman of IIT Amravati Center. Then Dr. Varsha Harpule, and many more distinguished personality and the are present over here. I welcome them all and all the audience, all the faculty members, all the IIT members for this today's program, and take the privilege to introduce today's chief guest, Dr. Mamta Chandra Prakash Padole. Dr. Mamta Padole is currently working as associate professor in the Department of Computer Science and Engineering, Faculty of Technology and Engineering at Maharaja Sayaji Rao University of Baroda, Vadodara. She did her PhD from Maharaja Sayaji Rao University of Baroda in 2014. She is also has done Master of MCA, Master of Computer Applications in 1996. She is Diploma in Management 2 and Diploma in German Studies 2. She has one patent to her name and 7 copyrights, around more than 35 publications in national and international journals, book chapters, conference proceedings. She has co-authored the school textbooks of Gujarat State Board. She has received various awards. One of them I would like to mention here, that best women IIT award, best women technocrats IIT awards. NPTEL translations, she has submitted around 11 lectures of NPTEL translation in Gujarati language for the subjects on Industry 4.0, Industrial Internet of Things, and so on. She has guided 2 PhD candidates successfully, and she has been advisor to Gujarat Public Service Commission for recruitment of assistant professors. She is the vice chairman of Computer Society of India, Vadodara chapter, regional student coordinator, honorary secretary CSI, Vadodara for 2016 to 2018. And currently she is very much active in IIT. IIT, she is heading as a chairman the IIT Center of Vadodara, and handling 3 PAC center, professional IIT professional activity centers. This is really our privilege to have Madam with us to chair the today's session. Now I request Mamta Madam and request Kiran Karade Madam to proceed further.
Thank you very much, sir. I would like to request our distinguished chief guest to bless the function with his kind words.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning, everybody. Good morning, President, IIT President Dr. Bakkal, and the ex-president Dr. K.T.V. Reddy. Good morning to all the governing council members present in the occasion, Dr. Thakre, Dr. Kasat, Dr. Javandhya, and everybody, all the senior members, Professor Singh, Ajinder Singh, who is present over here. Good morning to Professor Manish Tibrewal, who is the speaker for today's session.
Thank you.
Good morning to all the IIT members who are present in the event and to the students. Nuktaat past September la Shikshak Din apla sampla, ani sagrya Gurujan na ithe mi namaskar karte, and upasthit with Jayasya and Snehashish. Good morning to everybody, and I thank Professor Gulhane to give me the opportunity to be part of this particular event under IIT Professional Activity Center, Pravara, Loni. So I thank you, sir, and it is indeed a privilege to speak on such a prevalent topic of interest and topic of research in the current day scenario, signal processing and image processing in medical applications. Professor Dibdewal would be speaking in detail about the medical applications and techniques applied, but I would like to draw attention to the researchers and the students present over here. When we talk about healthcare in general can be divided into three parameters, right? One is ERP applications involved in healthcare. For example, very fundamental things like hospital management, right? We get to know the details about the hospitals. We get to know the details about the doctors who are present in the hospital, and we can take online appointments. We can register for any kind of admissions to the hospitals, the billing aspect of the hospitals, the internal management of the hospitals. That is one part of healthcare, right? So basically, I would put it as ERP for hospital management and billing. And then it also involves insurance, which is attached to the hospital aspects, right? Or basically to the patient treatment. So this in general is ERP for hospital management. The second aspect, which I'm sure Professor Sibdewal would be speaking in detail, is dealing with the data that is available in medical applications.
Yeah.
So I have been attending for past few days, for maybe last three sessions I had attended, and various speakers spoke about the medical data. Typically, when we talk about signal processing or application of artificial intelligence, machine learning, and deep learning for signals which are generated, typically ECG signals, EMG signals, and EEG signals, right? When we say ECG signals, it talks about electrocardiogram, that is the behavior or the status of an individual's heart, right? When we talk about EMG, EMG stands for electromyograph, and that talks about the health of the muscular health of the individual, that is the physical health of the individual. And when we talk about EEG, electroencephalograph, we are talking about the brain status of the individual. So how the brain is functioning, about which we had a very good talk from Professor Ingole in the last presentation. So these are, and in we also have discussed quite sometimes about image processing, and typically when it comes to image processing, people talk about cancer data, okay? So the images received through X-rays, MRI, CT scans, okay? So these are the broad aspects which normally people talk about when we are discussing about medical application. There is a third and a very important aspect when we talk about medical applications, and that is bioinformatics in general. The bioinformatics, medical applications are part of bioinformatics, but when we use the term bioinformatics, it typically talks about genetics. And genetics is a very, very important aspect of medical science, because the prediction of diseases and the treatment of diseases is possible through genetics. There are several genetic diseases like Alzheimer's. When we talk about Alzheimer's or different types of dementias, Professor Ingole spoke about different types of dementias last time, and specific to that is Alzheimer's disease, which is caused in old age people at the old age because of the dysfunctioning of human cells. I would talk typically the cells, not the brain in general. Okay? There's a neural network in a brain, the biological neural network. I'm not talking of artificial neural network. There's a biological neural network in the brain which starts dysfunctioning because the neurons get disconnected from each other. So the brain signals are not transmitted properly. And if the brain signals are not transmitted properly or they do not receive the signals properly, human being cannot function. Simple things like when he mentioned about dementia or brain diseases, he also mentioned about Parkinson's disease. So basically these are nothing but related to signals of the brain. Now all this, there is Huntington's disease. We talk about the children cerebral palsy, right? These are the diseases which are caused due to genetics. And it is a very important aspect of medical application. When we talk about genetics in general, there are four aspects again. The study of genes, the study of genomes, the study of proteomes, and the study of metagenomics. Now, genes, in general, genes are nothing but the DNA of the human being. And you will be surprised to know 99% of DNA sequence for all the human beings is common. So what differentiates one person from the other person is just 1% of DNA. And when we are talking about DNA, if you consider, many of you must have studied in biology, DNA is a double helix structure. So if you can process DNA through image processing, and if DNA is sequenced, sequencing of DNA means identifying the nucleotide bases which form the DNA sequence. And DNA, the alphabet for DNA, or the basic comprising component of DNA is A, T, C, G. These are known as nucleotide bases, which are nothing but chemical components or chemical compounds which get connected to each other, and through their chemical bonding, we get the double helix structure. So when you are studying about the partial portion of DNA, or just one portion of the DNA, which is referred as a gene, which is responsible for a single activity, like, or a single phenomenon. For example, if the color of my eyes is black, it is because of one particular gene which is active or plays an important role in the identification of the color of an individual. If my color of hair is, let us say, brown, then it is another gene which is responsible for that color. So not just the physical aspects, but the physiological aspect of the individual is also based on the functionality of the gene which is present in the organism. And when I say gene, it is not related to only human beings. The plants and the animals are also having a particular functionality because of the genetic component out of which they are made of. Right? But when we consider a human being, DNA is a building component, but DNA individually is not playing an important role. Every human being, or every organism for that matter, is made of a cell. And cell comprises of nucleotide, we know. And the nucleotide is formed of chromosome. And chromosome is, the building block of chromosome is amino acids. So you must have heard in childhood also, we say to our children that dal acche se khao, proteins lo. People who are non-vegetarian take eggs. Otherwise, you take milk properly. The reason is the proper protein intake is very important for the good health of an individual. And protein is nothing but the chemical compounds formed of amino acids. And three DNA nucleotide bases. So as I told you, A, T, C, G, adenine, cytosine, thymine, and guanine. These are the four chemical components, also referred as nucleotide bases, which together, so there's a sequence, a long sequence. You will be surprised, 3 into 10 raised to 9. 3 into 10 raised to 9 is the size of the DNA sequence, of a human DNA sequence, right? There are organisms which have the DNA sequence of the size 10 raised to 15 and beyond that. Now, what is important is, I'll explain in a simple manner. If you take a string name, we write a C program, string name, and I'm assigning the value Mamta in it. Okay? Now, if I ask the student to search the substring AM in this string Mamta, he will have to do substring character by character comparison of the substring AM with the given string MAMTA, right? So it is N cross M comparison. The N cross M comparison. That means this is the complexity of exponential complexity, right? So if you have to find a pattern in a DNA sequence which is of the size 3 into 10 raised to 9. So one string size is 3 into 10 raised to 9 characters. And these characters are nothing but not A to Z, A, C, G, T. That's it, four characters. And from this particular character, we have to identify a substring. Okay? This substring, again, may be few thousand characters. And these substrings may occur at different locations in this DNA sequence. So when we have to identify a disease, we identify a gene for a specific disease. If we want to identify the entire, if we want to study the entire DNA sequence, the study is known as genomics. The one full single DNA is genome, right? And the three characters, take ACG, it will form one amino acid. You take CGT, it may form another amino acid. You take TGA, it may form a third amino acid. So likewise, there are 20 such amino acids which form proteins, and these group of proteins are nothing but again another chemical compound which have different forms. When I say different forms, they are combined to each other to form 2D structure, 3D structure, n-dimensional structures. And the doctors study these protein structures to identify a particular disease. Typically, when we say somebody has a brain tumor or somebody has a tumor in a heart or lung or any other body, they are studying the protein structure of that particular tumor. And if we want to resolve or we want to treat this disease altogether, then you have to mutate the gene. Mutation means converting. See, already the disease has been caused because of mutation. There was some change that has occurred in our DNA sequence during our lifetime. And these changes may occur because of the environment in which we are living. For example, if somebody is exposed too much to chemical compounds, if somebody is staying in a chemical zone, lot of chemical industries in and around their habitat, then this is an environment effect. It can be a physiological change because of our food habits, because of our lifestyle. That physiological changes may occur, which in turn may mutate the gene. Mutation of gene doesn't happen in one day. It happens in a continuous process because of the changes in protein structures.
Madam,
amino acids. Yes, I'm just completing. What my concern was, these are different domains. I wanted to throw attention to this bioinformatics domain, typically genetics or genomics and proteomics. You can do the study of these areas through signal processing. And those who are interested for image processing also, you can do 2D modeling, 3D modeling of the tumors to find out. See, when you do CT scan or when you do MRI scan, you get the picture of the portion which has been exposed to that scanning. What is beneath that portion which cannot be scanned can be studied through 3D modeling, okay? And again, the genetic study can be done through signal processing. Those who are interested may go through my PhD thesis placed in Shodhganga, where I have applied wavelet transforms to identify the patterns in DNA sequences, which is in turn studying the repetitive sequence responsible for causing different genetic diseases, right? So what I wanted to pay attention is the third dimension of medical applications, and that is genetics and genomics. Researchers can pay attention to these areas also, and do signal processing and image processing for modeling purpose to identify different diseases and their treatments. So I could go on for another 2-3 hours, but thank you. We will have some session again. With this, I thank the organizers, Professor Gulhane and Professional Activity Center, IIT Pravara, Rural College of Engineering, Loni, for giving me the opportunity to be part of this event. Thank you so much. And
thank you, madam.
To all the students. Thank you.
Thank you. Just I wanted to say that madam has also accepted to be to be a speaker for one of the session where she will be talking more about this DNA sequence image processing application and signal processing application in these DNA sequences, and definitely we will be in the next month, in the month of, because specifically madam has requested that it has to be organized, that lecture has to be organized in the month of October. So we will be definitely get the opportunity to listen more to the madam. Now I request Kiran Kharde madam to proceed for the next program.
Thank you very much, ma'am, for your valuable inputs. Now I invite Mrs. S.Y. Rao, member, Professional Activity Center and HOD IT, PRC Loni, to introduce keynote speaker of today's function, Dr. Manish Tibdewar, Professor, Department of Electronics and Telecommunication Engineering, Sri Santa Gajanan Maharaj College of Engineering, Shevgaon, Buldhana.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Just a minute, please. I would like to here mention that Dr. Mahesh Kolekar from IIT Patna also are among with us. He has also joined. Welcome, sir. Now, Rao madam.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you, Professor Gunale.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Respected principal.
Hello. Hi. Yes, sir. Thanks. Thanks a lot for joining. Yes.
No mention. Yeah, topic is interesting, so I thought let us see.
Sure, sir. Your
Manish will explain. Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, madam.
Respected principal, sir, our today's chief guest, keynote speaker, all the respected members of IIT and all the participants. I am Mrs. S.Y. Rao, Head of Department, Information Technology, welcoming you all for the today's webinar on role of signal and image processing in medical applications. We are very fortunate today we have with us an eminent speaker, Dr. Manish Tibdewar, working as a professor in Electronics and Telecommunication Engineering. Sir completed PhD from IIT Kharagpur. Sir also having a 30 years of experience in teaching and research. Sir also working as a reviewer as a SCI Index Journal of Springer, Elsewhere, IEEE Transaction and other. He is an executive member of IIT Amravati region. Sir have published total 37 papers in various international journals and also attended a total 37 conferences and seminars. Thank you so much, sir, for accepting our request as a keynote speaker for today's webinar. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Now I request Dr. Manish Tibdewar, sir, to proceed for the session.
Thank you, sir. Am I audible clearly?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. So I shall now share my slide. Just a minute, give me a minute. The slideshow is visible?
Yes, sir, visible.
Thank you. Thank you very much, all. I am very good morning to one and all this August gathering as a part of webinar. We are participating in the webinar, and I am trying to discuss the webinar on the topic role of signal and image processing in the medical applications. It is organized by Pravara Rural Engineering College, Loni. I am humbly thankful to honorable management of Pravara Engineering College. I am also thankful to respected Dr. Principal Dr. Gulane sir. Also thankful to regional authorities of IIT, national authorities of IIT, Dr. Bakkal sir, and all my respected teachers, central authorities of IIT members. I am thankful, humbly thankful to all. I am thankful to today's chief guest, Dr. Mamta madam. I am humbly thankful to my home college, honorable management, respected principal, respected HOD of my department, and thankful to Dr. C. B. Kadu sir and Mrs. S. S. Lavate madam, who is organizing this IIT webinar in a serious manner. I am thankful to all the participant and organizing member for taking the pains since 4-5 months for arranging such knowledge transfer, or we can say good activity in the region. Even if I have the huge experience of teaching about 30 years, and I have presented the about 7 IEEE paper and 4-5 SCI index paper in the journals, and the remaining conference and all papers, I am child of 12 year old in the biomedical field, actually in the biomedical signal processing field. I am trying to discuss some of the modalities in one dimensional and two dimensional biomedical signal processing. If in the discussion, if any mistake is committed or if any discussion is required, please stuck up me anytime. I will discuss with you and then we can proceed further. So now I shall start about the overview of the topic, today's topic. The content of the today's topic will be introduction to signal image processing and applications, introduction to biomedical signal processing and image processing, processing of biomedical signal is history and the classification, challenges with the biomedical signals, advancement in the biomedical signal and analysis, and the processing techniques are available nowadays. Then I'll be discussing briefly about EMG, ECG, and very detail about one of the piece of my PhD work. 40% piece of PhD work will be discussed under the EEG signal processing for artifact removal and detection. Brain, human brain, and the EEG rhythms will be discussed in detail. Various artifacts in the EEG and the will be discussed in detail. Artifact removal technique and the performance metrics with the conclusion will be discussed in detail. I am also touching briefly the physics of all the most of the medical image modalities such as MRI, X-ray, CT, sonography, PET, SPECT, etc. Medical image modality fusion, little bit I'll discuss, and the disease diagnosis and the research areas available in this all. And lastly, I'll discuss the online medical image and signal processing data are available, and also what are the avenues open for the medical data for the signal and image processing for the researcher and the you can say different types of workers. References I'll be touching. Now, sir, am I audible clearly?
Yes, sir.
Shall I proceed further now?
Yes, sir.
It is okay. Thank you. So, what is signal? We all are immersed in the sea of signals, basically. All of us from smallest living unit, like a cell, there are different cells in our body, as we all aware, to most complex living organism, that is human being. As we all aware, our body is most adaptive signal processing body. Since our body is susceptible to the temperature, right from 25 degrees Celsius to about 50 degrees Celsius. So there is no system in the world like this much adaptivity has. So human body and the human organism is so complex and the adaptive one. Actually, all the body organ will receiving and transmitting the signal time to time. That we have to understand in terms of the biomedical signal processing. And the signal defined as any physical quantity represented as the function of one or more variable which conveys some useful information about that particular quantity. For example, suppose I will express the signal x of t. This is called as the one dimensional signal. If I explain the signal x comma y f of x comma y, this is the two dimensional signal. So the signal having one independent component is called as the one dimensional signal. Signal having two independent component is called as the two dimensional signal. Now most of the practical interest signals are analog in nature. Human speech, human voice, gesture, video, radar, sonar signals, transducer, sensor signals, biological output signals, earth signals, sky signal, bird chirping signals, and the music signal, etc. All are analog in nature. Even the electromagnetic field emanating from the transmitting antenna is also analog. Variation of light intensity in a fiber optic is also analog. Blind people uses the sense of touches for understanding is also analog signal. Bees communicating the signal by their dancing pattern to their colleagues, that is also analog. So most of the signal in nature are analog. Modern high-speed signals are the voltage charger in the telephone wires are considered to be as the analog. Now this is the generalized procedure to convert the signal and signal acquisition from the sensors. So we have to convert the signal from analog domain to the digital domain for the digital signal processing in the image form or the one-dimensional form. Actually, we are minimum following the Nyquist criteria for the sampling of signal must be greater than twice the maximum signal frequency. This is the Nyquist criteria we are following minimum for sampling and quantization. Basically, I can give the natural example of sampling for a scene or image in the daily routine life by the eyes. The eyes are flickering many times in a second or in a minute. So eyes are taking sample of the scene for every 1 millisecond, we can say. So this is nothing but the sampling. We can say the digitization of time is nothing but the sampling, and digitization of magnitude is nothing but the quantization. And further, quantization process required the coding for the machine processing in the digital way. As such, there is no technical endeavor wherein the digital signal processing and digital image processing is not impacted. I mean to say, everywhere the signal processing is impacted. You can take the communication field, there are lot many applications in the research and the academics are available. Even in the application orientation, the lot many applications are available in communication. I'm not going detail of the application, just trying to convey you the applications of signal and image processing. Then voice and speech application, consumer electronics applications, audio applications, video applications, multimedia applications, social media applications nowadays, instrumentation applications, industrial control and automation, robotics applications, biomedical application, agriculture application, and military application. I would ask to the researcher that one should go for the application which are need-based. One should go for the translational research or the basic research for the need-based of the society. And if you will take up the need-based from the society, from the biomedical field, from the agriculture field, or from the military field, these fields require research at most, or every time this field require research. So we have to work on this, and this field will be make our nation, basically. Luxury has been happened, and most of the research has been happened with the luxurious life, everything. But now, every researcher should inculcate the values in the biomedical field, military field, and the agriculture field. This is my personal opinion for the signal and image processing applications. Now, the basic or the core function associated with any activity is the signal and its processing. Whatever signal we have will be categorized in broad sense in two ways. First is the determining signal, and second is the stochastic signal. In the determining signal, we have the periodic, quasi-periodic such as ECG, and the transient signal, wave shape having occurred only once. In the stochastic signal, we have stationary and non-stationary type of signal. The stationary signal having the statistical properties are constant. The non-stationary signal having the statistical properties are changing ever, for every millisecond or for every microsecond. Then introduction to biomedical signal. Biomedical signal and the image processing establish a dynamic area of specialization in both academics as well as the research aspect of the biomedical engineering. The concept of signal and image processing have been widely used for extracting the physiological information in implementing many clinical procedures for sophisticated medical practices, diagnosis, treatment, treatment planning, then machine guided surgery and application, etc. These are the amenities or these are the basic things or the general things available with the signal and image processing in the biomedical field nowadays. And we are using daily in the daily life with the physician. No physician nowadays in his clinic or no doctor in his clinic available without electronic instrument. So many of the system nowadays in many of the aspect or in many of the discipline, the we are merged by the electronic instruments, we can say, or the signals and system. So biologic signals carrying information that is useful for compression of the complex pathophysiological mechanism which is underlying the behavior of the living system. No doubt it is very important to study the genomes, DNA, metabolism or different types of functioning with the body and we can say different types of organ. But along with that, if one could study the signal and image processing for the different application, that will be helpful to the society for its need base. The biomedical signal analysis centers on the acquisition and the processing of information which are carrying the signal, information carrying in terms of the signal, right? So these vital signals permit us to probe the state of underlying biologic and physiologic structure of the and the dynamics of the human being body. So here interpretation has significant diagnosis. Actually we have to interpret along with the physician, that the engineers are doing the quantitative analysis and physician are doing to a certain extent the qualitative analysis. Nowadays even the most of the disciplines of the engineers are doing the qualitative analysis also along with the quantitative analysis. The days are not long that every engineer can be the doctor. Or I have one example in my institute, IIT Kharagpur. Dr. S.K. Guha is a doctor as well as engineer. He is the first person I think in the India who is doctor as well as engineer from the doctor from the AIIMS and engineer from the IITs like that. So the days are not long that one should have the interdisciplinary way of working. Most of the one-dimensional biomedical signals are of basic two types. The first type is the action potential and second is the event-related potential. So under action potential we got EMG, ENG, ECG, EEG. These are under the action potential. And under the event-related potentials, in one-dimensional biomedical signal, we have EGG, electrogastrogram, phonocardiogram, PCG, cardiac pulse, CP, signal from the catheter tip sensors, speech signal, vibromyogram, vibroorthogram, autoacoustic emission signals, etc. Now, origin of the biomedical signal. There are seven origin of the biomedical signal from the human being body and from the animal's body we have. So I'm not going very detail of the origin of the biomedical, just the brief of origin of the biomedical signal I'm giving here. First type is bioelectric signal. It is unique to the biomedical system generated by the nerve cells and the muscle cells. Its source is membrane potential, which under certain condition may be excited to generate the action potential. Then bioimpedance signal. So impedance of the tissue contains the important information concerning its composition, blood volume, blood distribution, endocrine activity, automatic nervous system activity, and many more. Biomagnetic signal. Various organs such as brain, heart, lung produce the extremely weak electromagnetic signals. So due to low level of the magnetic signal or the field we have to measure and tackle the problem of artifact in the low level biomagnetic signal. So these biomedical signals are usually very low signal to noise ratio. Then many more acoustic signals are available. So this measurement of acoustic signal provides the information about phenomenon underlined. The flow of blood in heart through the heart walls, through the blood vessels, typically acoustic noise, the flow of air through the upper and lower airways, and in the that is in the lungs, which creates the acoustic sound, and the sound known as the cough, nose, chest, lung sounds are need to extensively in the medicine. So these sounds are clinically, or we can say biomedically, will be judged by the physician. The biochemical signals are the result of chemical measurement and chemical actions under the body, between the living tissues of the body, right? So biochemical signals are most often very low frequency signal. They are most of the biochemical signals are actually DC signal, very low frequencies. Then biomechanical signal we have. The biomechanical signal include all the signals used in the biomedicine that originate from the mechanical function of the biological system. These signals include motion and the displacement of the signal, pressure, tension, flow signals, etc. Biooptical signal, last type of the signal origins from the human being bodies and the animals, that is the biooptical type. So biooptical signal results of optical function of the biologic system, which is occurring naturally or induced by measurement. Blood oxygenation, which will be estimated by the measuring transmitted, measuring the transmitted and backscattered light from the tissue, that is in YO manner or in YCO manner, in the several wavelengths. Bioelectrical classification, biosignal classification. So we have already, I told you, we have bioelectric action potential type and the event potential type, right? So here we have the different types of parameters shown in this table. I am not going very detail of this parameter, just referring this parameter, we could understand what is the range of frequencies available for the various signal, what is the dynamic range of the amplitude available, and the comment is given for every type of signal here. So we got here ENG, ERG, UOG, EEG, then EEG various signals like delta, theta, alpha, beta. I'll be going in detail in my further core part of the discussion for this EEG. We are looking forward in brief here for the signal classification. Then evoke potential, visual evoke potential, somatosensory evoke potential, auditory evoke potential, then electrocardiogram, then we have EMG, then single fiber or the multi-fiber EMG. We have the amplitude of from 1 to about 100 microvolt of the EMG like that. Then we have the motor action potential, surface potential, skeletal muscle, smooth muscle, electrocardiogram from the heart, high frequency ECG like that. So these are the different types of signal classification available with the human body. Then history of the medical signal and the imaging. So ECG was developed in 1895 by William Enthoven. Enthoven triangle is very popular in the recording of ECG, as we are aware. EMG was developed in 1942. EEG was developed by Hansberger in 1924. Nuclear medicine was developed by Oak Ridge, 1946. X-rays was developed by Rontgen in 1895. So in 1895, X-rays in imaging modalities and ECG in single dimensional signal modality was developed in the initial development. In 19th century, end of the 19th century, the one-dimensional signal ECG was developed and two-dimensional signal image, that is medical image, X-rays was developed. So ultrasound was developed in 1958 by Ian Donald. Then SPECT was developed in 1963. Then PET was developed in 72. MRI was developed in 72. And the CT was developed in 72. So most of the development in the end of 20th century was developed in the imaging modality like PET, MRI and the CT. So there are a lot many advancement has been happened with the SPECT, MRI, CT, X-rays and all. Nowadays, even image modalities are being fused together for different types of application and the disease understanding. So this is the brief history of the signal and imaging available. Then some important terms always come across with us in the medical signal and image processing. Briefly, I am explaining here. Invasive means it is the introduction of instrument or its part of the instrument into the object of the body. Non-invasive means the relating to the technique that does not involve functioning the skin or the body, entering into the body cavity. In vivo means refers to test, experiments, procedure that the researcher perform in whole living organism, such as person or the laboratory animals. In vitro means studies are performed with the microorganism, cells or biological molecules outside their normal biological context. Etiology, branch of medical science concerned to the science of causes, origin of diseases and pathology. Epidemiology is the study of spread of disease affecting the state health in the area wise or in the state wise or the nation wise, we can say. Prevalence is the statistical concept that is referring to the number of cases of a disease are present in the particular population. Incidence refer to the number of new cases that develop in the given period of time, right? Then challenges with the biomedical signal. Just look to this diagram I have given at the right side of the slide. Here the noise level is more higher than the signal level. That is the great challenge in the biomedical one-dimensional as well as in the two-dimensional signal processing. So as you can see here, EEG having the signal frequency from about 1 hertz to 100 hertz. The ECG having the signal frequency from 0.1 hertz to about 100 hertz. And the EMG having the signal frequency from about 5 hertz to 10 kilohertz like that. And the magnitude of EMG is about 100 millivolt maximum or 50 millivolt maximum. Magnitude of ECG maximum we have about 1 to 2 millivolt, and magnitude of ECG maximum we have 100 microvolt. But over the level of or the magnitude of all the most of the biomedical signal, the range of noise is very large, you can see, or very high. The range of noise in the signal is about greater than 100 millivolt, and it is up to 10 volt sometime. So this is very great challenge to the physician and to the researcher also. We have to minimize as possible the artifacts in the signal. So biomedical signal has got very low signal to noise ratio. It has got the non-stationarity and the non-linearity property. It has diverse type of the noise. Noise and artifacts overlap both in spectral and the temporal domain. That means in time domain and the frequency domain, both domains. Then false alarms and the errors can mislead sometime with the diagnosis, treatment, and treatment planning and the control. And the traditional signal processing techniques are less applicable for the biomedical signal. Then different types of biofeedback. EMG is the measurement signal from the muscles. Thermal biofeedback measuring from the skin. Then EEG measure from the brain activity. EDG measure from the electrical activity of the skin. Then heat flux body measures the rate at which the heat is being dissipated from the body. Then mammography measures the abdominal or chest movement with the breathing. Then capnometry measures the end-tidal carbon dioxide. Then hemoencephalography measures the differences in color of light reflected back to the skull based on the relative amount of oxygenated and the unoxygenated blood in the brain. Then we have the PPG signal. Nowadays, the PPG signal is being modeled for various types of wearing instrument like measurement of SpO2, oxygen saturation, blood flow, rate of the our heart, or heart rate variability, or even blood pressure. Or the people are working on the measurement of the hemoglobin, or measurement of the, say, sometimes the different blood parameters of blood smears. The people are working in the research with the PPG and the different types of biofeedback signal. The limitation of biofeedback signals, their applications is lay largely on the therapist, basically. Now, the biomedical signal processing and the advanced techniques are available for the biomedical signal and image processing. I'm just listing here. In the later part of discussion, we'll be using some techniques. Time frequency analysis in the both domain, Then we have the Fourier transform domain analysis, spectral feature analysis, spatial feature analysis, then signal enhancement with the optimal filtering and the adaptive filtering. It is a great challenge, I told you, we have in the biomedical signal of the various types of noises to be filtered or artifact to be filtered. Then minimization of MSE, maximization of signal to noise ratio, segmentation of non-stationary signal. These are all techniques and challenges also associated with the techniques and the new techniques. We have to define the parameters also. Then we have the discrete Fourier transform with the all types of methodology with it. Then the blind source separation, we have independent component analysis, principal component analysis, VCA, MCA likewise. Then wavelet transform and the STFT along with the wavelet transform, of the different types of wavelet transform, wavelet, mother wavelets we are using nowadays. Empirical techniques, HST, EMD, EEMD we are using nowadays. Adaptive filtering, use of reference signal is required for that. Then the priori user input required for the Wiener filtering, Kalman filtering, or the particle filtering, and the different types of classification are sometimes doing with the priori knowledge. Supervised way or the unsupervised way, we are doing the classification. Then higher order spectrum analysis, NOA analysis, degree of freedom analysis, higher order spectrum analysis to the polynomial signal, like signal order greater than 2. We have to go for the higher order spectrum analysis. And nowadays the people are working on this also for the different types of signal processing. Now brief about the EMG. EMG basically is the neurophysiological technique for examining the electrical activity of the skeletal muscle. Electrical activity of the skeletal muscle. Sir, am I audible clearly, Gulani sir?
Yes, sir. Audible, sir.
Proceed further.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. So, EMG signal, recording of the muscle action potential, and source of the electrical signal in the EMG is the muscle membrane. Muscle fibers innervated by the axonal branches of the motor neuron from the motor unit. The test is used to help to detect the neuromuscular abnormalities. EMG is to diagnose the muscle and nerve disease and conditions. During the test, one or more small needles are inserted through the skin. And through the skin, we have the muscle fibers. Those muscle fibers, we are inserting the skins or the surface electrode sometime for the recording of EMG signal. So this is the basic physiology as well as we can say, basic physics and the what for EMG is used, that is narrated here. Now these are the types of EMG electrodes we have: needle electrode, fine electrode, surface electrode. Nowadays we have the dye electrode also on the scalp or the skin to record the EMG and the EEG signal. Then this is the recording methodology in which we have the electrical potential difference measured between the two points by the bipolar electrode. And these are the configuration or the names of the bipolar electrode we have. This is the picture given from this particular slide or given from this particular web page. And electrode placement will be overlying the muscles of the interest in the direction of predominant fiber. So if we are connecting two electrodes under the two muscle fiber, I will be getting the bipolar signal. If we are connecting one electrode to the active fiber and one is with the ground, I will be getting the monopolar signal subject to ground. Then this is the diagram shown here for the normal and abnormal EMG activity. If the EMG activity having the level of frequency given in the classification, or we know that, and the magnitude will be up to the mark or up to the normal level, we can say that is the normal EMG. So all the EMG above up to 100 microvolt will be the normal EMG. But here you can see this is also normal. It is a hazy pattern we got in the normal EEG many times. And this is the abnormal EEG having the magnitude greater than about 1 millivolt. Neuropathic disease is there with the skin. Myopathic disease is there with the skin. So these are also the pattern for the abnormal EMG. I am going briefly introduction of every modality, not very detailed. Now what is ECG? And electrocardiogram is a painless, non-invasive way to help the diagnosis of many common heart problems in the subjects. A physician may use the ECG to determine the abnormal heart rhythm. If the blockage is there and narrow arteries will be there, that is coronary artery disease, and the chest pain is caused, heart attack is caused, that is myocardial infarct, where there you have had the previous heart attack, you have to go for the ECG routinely. Then how well certain heart disease treatments such as pacemaker are working properly or not, for that the physician is going for the ECG. Now this is the conducting system of the heart, from SA node to AV node, from AV node, SA node to AV node through the internodal pathways. The signal is transmitting, here the stimulus is given, and to AV node to the AV bundle, AV bundle to the branches and the Purkinje fiber, and the signal is generating to the intervene triangle and the different types of protocol of the signal recording. I am not going very detail of the signal recording and everything. You may need the ECG. You have any of the following signs or the symptoms. If you have a chest pain, dizziness, then lightheadedness or the confusion, heart palpitations will be increasing or decreasing, very small, very small palpitation will be there, or the very heavy palpitation will be there. Then rapid pulse, that is the fast heart rate, shortness of the breath, weakness, fatigue, or the decline in the ability to exercise, nausea, vomiting, and the anxiety. These are the some of the symptoms or the signs for which we have to go for the ECG. I am just sharing the list of the heart disease before you, for your knowing only. We have total 82 types of the heart disease listed here. Only about 50% heart disease we could process the signal. Still, there is very much scope is available in the ECG signal to magnify, or to not magnify means not just increasing the average value or just looking the signal very correctly. Magnifying the different spectral, spatial, electrical parameter of the signal, and if we try to look by the spect of signal processing to the ECG disease or ECG of the heart disease, we can help to the physician more, I think. And there are number of areas are available still in the research for the different types of heart disease. This is the normal ECG look like. The one ECG cycle, as we all aware, ECG cycle is the quasi periodic one, and one ECG cycle is of about 0.833 seconds, and 0.833 second into 72, if you multiply, we'll get 1 minute 72 pulses from the heart. So this is the QRS, complex PQRST, and new wave is there. This is the general general wave is showing how the ECGs look. Now some diseases ECG I have collected from the websites and the papers that I am narrating here. An acute myocardial infarct is the uncommon pattern we are getting here. There's the cutting cut pattern and the uncommon pattern of the ECG available for this disease. Or it is giving like this. This disease is giving like this. The inferior ST segment elevation myocardial infarct, the signals will be resulted like this. Then the posterior ST segment elevation MI will be resulted this type of waveform or this type of ECG. Then interior posterior segment ST segment elevation for MI. So this type of ECG will be resulted. Acute MI with the right bundle branch block. Acute MI will be resulted with the right bundle branch block. Now I have just gone through the newspaper in before 7 days, before a week. I got this news from the European Society of Cardiology. उन्होंने ऐसा पेश किया है, अभी the research is still going on. They are making a machine for the measurement of the heart attack. हार्ट अटैक का खतरा पहले ही बता देगी अल्ट्रा एक्यूरेट स्कैन टेक्निक. एंजियोग्राफी से 60% 70% हमको रिजल्ट मिलता है, अब इस मशीन से हमको 80% ठीक ढंग से रिजल्ट मिलेगा, और हमारा हार्ट में कितना ब्लॉकेज है, और एक्यूरेट स्कैन में 80% तक हमारे हार्ट में जो घातक ब्लॉकेजेस है वह पहचान पाएंगे हम. European Society of the Cardiologists has developed, or they are being developing this particular system. In the initial part, they have developed this system. Now, this is one slogan I want to quote here. I'm reading here, the son and father conversation is there, very small conversation. Dad, in your time, there was no mobile, no mobile phones, no internet, no computers, no Google. What did you use in the school? So this is the son was asked to his dad. The dad answered, brain, my son. This is one of the token or one of the slogan I want to just show you for creating a humor. Then I am giving you the details about the EEG signal processing and the artifact detection and removal. Now onward this slide, about 40% of my doctoral work I'm trying to explain before you in the one-dimensional signal processing with the EEG. And I have worked on the EEG as a biomarker for automatic detection of epilepsy using various types of epilepsy, and the EEG signal has been recorded from the hospital itself. And I have been in contact with the Dr. Malukar madam, Dr. Baheti, Dr. Tauri from the SIMS Nagpur, and I have been contacted to Leelavati Hospital to the Bombay. So I have collected many data or many subjects data of EEG, MRI from the hospitals. And I am daily weekly visiting to the hospital for collecting the data and discussion with the neurophysician and the neurosurgeons, and as well radiologists too. So now I am onward this slide, I am explaining you about the detailed signal processing. About 30 to 40 slides I am explaining about the detailed signal processing of EEG for the artifact detection, artifact removal, and the performance metrics of the artifact we have presented in the, or we have published in the SCI index papers. So now this is the brain, you know all. We got the four outer lobes in the brain, and we are collecting non-invasively the electroencephalogram from the brain. So this is the actual signal I am collecting from the hospital. For the normal EEG signal, we got the magnitude is about 60 microvolt. And from the epileptic EEG signal, from the abnormal subject, we have collected the EEG signal with the higher frequency as well as very higher magnitude, about 300 microvolt. Now human brain. Already in the last week discussion, the brain and this system was explained by the Professor P.V. Ingole. I am not going into detail of that. But just for keeping the harmony in the topic, I am explaining the brain. So this is a very complex organ, we know. And this organ will be controlling the heart rate, emotions, then integrating the activities of the human beings, learning, memory, and coordinating the all information of the activities of the human being. The brain is even thought to the influence to the human systems, responses to the diseases, and the it is determining how well the people respond to the medical treatments. It has got four lobes: in the outer lobe, parietal lobe, frontal lobe, temporal lobe, and the occipital lobe. And the central system, central region, and the limbic region inside this brain we have. Along with that, we have this cerebellum, and the chota mendu isko bolte hain, and the brainstem. Brainstem is also part of the brain, right? It is called as the tail of the brain, basically. Now, brain divides into three regions, basically. Forebrain, midbrain, and the hindbrain. So this is the forebrain part, in which we have the all the lobes in the cerebrum. Then amygdala, hippocampus, pineal gland, pituitary gland, hypothalamus, and thalamus. This is forebrain. And then we have midbrain. This part is the midbrain. All the connections with the basal ganglion and all will be made with the midbrain and the forebrain part of the system. And this is the hindbrain. Pons, cerebellum, and medulla oblongata. And then spinal cord. This part of the brain is called as the hindbrain. So brain shapes our thoughts, hopes, dreams, and the imagination. It makes us who we are. Basically, brain is a, we can say, central processing unit of the human body. The brain is controlling the complete body actions, all types of body actions. But who is controlling the brain? The brain is controlled by the thought process, right? Brain is controlled by our hopes, our dreams, and our imagination. If we have the good thoughts, good hopes, and best dreams, and the best imagination, definitely will be work like that. So it makes us who we are. Brain makes us who we are. And this is the smallest element of the brain is neuron. It has got dendrite, soma, nucleus, axon, and myelin sheath. And neuron to neuron, through the axon, the information is being transmitted through the neurotransmitters, and the chemical exchanges were there. I'm not going very detail of this all, but just trying to briefing you about the brain cell, neuron as a brain cell. Each nerve cell body is called as the soma, has single neuron, an axon, and the dendrites. Neuron, electrically active cell. Neuron primarily responsible for carrying out the brain functions. Neurons transmit the information in terms of the nerve impulses. And the action potential is generated to the neurons, and the information is transmitted to the, we have the millions of neurons in our brain. So these actions have been taken place in the membranes of the neurons. Hypopolarization, depolarization, hypopolarization here, then depolarization, then overshoot, repolarization, and the hyperpolarization. So all these points are related with this all types of polarization. An action potential will be generated in the body of the neuron and propagate through the axon. As you are aware that, as being the electrical electronic signal processing engineer, we know this equation. The same equation is useful in action potential also. So the capacitance between the membranes and the charge on the membranes will create the action potential. So action potential is equal to Q by Cm. So this is the sodium inflow and potassium outflow through the various types of polarization takes place, and the action potential will be generated. And this EEG signal is the most complex, most nonlinear, most random signal is available with the brain. Now, what is EEG? EEG is the non-invasive recording technique we are taking from the brain with the protocol. EEG is nothing but the signature of the brain. Due to rhythmic nature of the brain activity, it is analyzing with the various frequency rhythms. They are named according to their frequencies and the magnitude. These are the EEG shown for the active action, relaxed action, drowsy action, light sleep action, and the deep sleep actions. A lot many projects and a lot many researchers are doing the work on this all types of EEG, right? So there are number of avenues are open on research side for the EEG processing or ECG processing or EMG processing in the biomedical signal processing. Now, use of EEG for the diagnosis. To support a clinical diagnosis of epilepsy, we have got the 40 types of epilepsy, and we classify the seizures. I could work in my research about 2-3 types of epilepsy, and the artifact detection, removal, and the automatic detection of epilepsy as a biomarker. Only 30 to 40% part of the doctoral work I am explaining here. Use of diagnosing the brain death is possible with the EEG to monitor the depth of anesthesia. Still, the anesthesia monitor is not available as an electronic instrument in most of the hospitals. In the Chennai Apollo Chennai, the IIT Kanpur is being testing the anesthesia monitor since 10 years, but they are not succeeded fully for the anesthesia monitor till. But some researchers are working on this anesthesia monitor. The use avenues are open to work on anesthesia monitor through EEG. Monitoring the secondary brain damage, EEG is often used to study the effective dementia, diagnosis of tumors, stroke, and the focal brain disorders. It is used for detection of the sleep disorder, that is insomnia, is the great problem today of many of us. Useful of the finding coma staging, etc. These are the various applications of EEG for detection. Now, this is the EEG recording I am showing you. This EEG recording is with the protocol of 1020 system. 1020 system is nothing but the distance between the two points for the measurement of the bipolar or unipolar signal from the brain skull of the human being. So here you can see to the right side of the brain we have numbered the electrode by even order, FP2, FZ, FZ, CZ, PZ are the central electrodes. Thus F4, C4, P4, O2, T6, T4, F8 are the electrodes from the right side of the brain, that is the right hemisphere, and all the odd number electrodes from the left hemisphere. So on the left side we use the odd number, and on the right side we use the even number. 1020 system is an international acquisition system for the signal. EEG signal is available in most of the hospitals and the neurophysicians, and it is very popular and useful. For high grid signals and the arrays we require, we are using 10-5 system with the 64 and the 128 electrodes. So different sets of the electrodes arrangement will be there as a montage. If I am taking the signal between the active electrode and the NaCN and the NaN are the, you can say, reference electrodes, it is called as the unipolar signal. If I am taking the signal between two active electrodes, it is called as the bipolar signal. This is the signal collected from the hospital for the normal adult. The magnitude of the signal, these are all 19 electrodes are available with the front polar, frontal, then temporal, central, then the parietal and the occipital lobe of the brain. So from all four lobes we got the 19 signals with respect to the reference A1 and A2. So these are the normal EEG signals collected for the normal adult. These are the various rhythms of the EEG signal. Delta having the, sorry, I will start from the beta. Beta having the frequency from 13 to 30. Then alpha having the frequency from 8 to 13. Theta having the frequency from 4 to 8. And delta having the frequency from 0.4 to 0.5 to 4 hertz. And the spikes for the epileptic grand mal and the petit mal will be like this. Sometime will be resulted with the amplitude greater than 100 microvolt. And the frequency is under the, you can say like, two or three sine frequencies are available in this, and with this spike we could understand that this is the abnormal signal of the EEG for the epilepsy. But they are not very concrete signal for the epilepsy. There are different types of signals also available for the different types of epilepsy. Now this table shown here the rhythms different and their amplitude and frequency. I'm not going to read every parameter here. For all of us understanding that delta rhythm is for the being achieved from the frontal in adults, posterior in from the children, and during sleep it can be recorded. Theta signal is majorly collected from the occipital region in young children, drowsiness or arousal in old children and adults. And if you have the emotional distress, the theta signal will be dominant. Alpha signal, closing the eyes, your awakened state, relaxing in the adults, alpha signal will be collected from the posterior region of the head, both sides, and the occipital region. Beta signal is from the adult mental activity, frontal region. It is in the awakened state, means problem solving or different types of, say, cognitive process here. No doubt, every type of cognitive process we are doing with every signal, but major cognitive process we can doing under the alpha and beta or beta and alpha. Then somatosensory cortex from which it is collected the gamma signals. Gamma signals shown during the short-term memory matching of the recognition of the object and sounds and the tactiles. Now what is EEG artifact? The artifact are basically undesired signal. Already a little bit brief I have given you about the artifact. The raw EEG is mixture of the ocular artifact in terms of the eye blink and eye movement artifact. The any potential difference due to extra cerebral source recorded in EEG also called as the artifact. I have told that eye blink artifact, EBA, and eye movement artifact causes by the potential difference between the cornea and retina, which creates the electrical dipole. And it is giving us the large magnitude of the signal and EEG being corrupted because of the eye blink and eye movement. Sometimes eye flickering also there. The artifacts are most difficult issues basically in the data analysis and data processing. So artifacts are summed linearly. It is exhibiting the superposition principle. Actually the signals are being mixed into the artifact signal are being mixed into the signal by two way. The first way is by the convolution, and second way by linear way. Suppose these are the two broad way. So normally EEG signals are mixed by the linear way, and the equation is exhibiting under the output of EEG will be like this. This is suppose EEG of raw signal is equal to EEG of clean signal plus ocular artifact type signal is being mixed linearly with the superposition principle in the EEG. Then we have the EEG artifact analysis. EEG, we have to, if we could have the reference EOG signal, which is nothing but the artifact, means parallelly recording of the EOG and EEG will be there. We can subtract the EOG from the EEG raw, and then we can get the clean EEG. But such is not the case available in most of the hospital in India. Sir, I am clearly audible.
Yes, sir. Audible, sir.
So, shall I proceed?
There is one. Sure, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, sir. So, in most of the hospitals of India, we don't have the reference signal. So, it is very difficult to clean the EEG from the artifact. The number of algorithms has been incorporated by different researchers. We are also trying to incorporate some algorithm and doing some artifact removal and the detection part in our research work. So now I am briefing those algorithms and the artifact removal and detection techniques. The different types of EEG artifacts are the physiological and the non-physiological. So we have got the ocular or the most prominent artifact in the EEG. That is of the order of greater than 200 to 400 or sometimes 500, 600 microvolt. So EMG is the this is the eye movement artifact and the eye blink artifact, fluttering and the rapid eye movement. So flutter and rapid eye movement are rarely appear as an artifact in the EEG, but eye movement and eye blink artifact are very frequently appear in the EEG as the ocular artifact. And on this we have worked. Actually, I have contacted to the physician, neurophysician, and asked for the problem in EEG. So Dr. Madam told me that you can work on the ocular artifact so that we can do the analysis very correctly for the EEG, for the various disease through the EEG. Then we can have the ECG artifact in the EEG, respiratory artifact, EMG, muscle artifact, skin, sweating artifact, and the glossokinetic artifact. These are the various artifacts available under the physiological artifacts in EEG. Then we have the non-physiological artifacts, movement of the patient, and then electrode displacement, mobile artifact or the electromagnetic signal artifacts, and the presence of intravenous drip is there sometime to the subject or the patient, so that will create the artifact. But these non-physiological artifacts are very rarely created or available in the EEG. Those data we can discard actually. Now this is the figure here given for types of EEG artifact. Nowadays we don't have the line or the power artifact in the EEG because the machine maker has already incorporated the software and the hardware for clearing the power line artifact from the EEG. Nowadays we don't have the power line artifact. In the older days before 20 year we have the power line artifact. Now this is the muscle artifact in the EEG. This is the electrode movement, eye blink, eye movement artifact, and this is the ECG artifact. Now the signals which are actually collected from the hospital with the patient consent, and on those signals we have worked for the eye movement and eye blink artifact detection, removal, and performance matrix. So among these all artifacts, I told you EEG and eye blink and eye movement artifacts are very prominent. Eye movement artifact and the eye blink artifacts are frequently occur, and they are very large in the magnitude than the normal EEG. These artifacts have got the very prominent peaks. You can see here this red color peaks are for the eye movement artifacts in the EEG. This another red color peaks are nothing but the eye blink artifact, and this green color signal is the normal EEG signal. So three types of signal I have shown here. The green color signal is the normal EEG signal. The blue color signal is the signal corrupted by eye blink artifact. And the pulse-like signal along with the spikes is the eye movement artifacted signal. More clearly, I have separated the signals. Just we can see on the slide. This is the artifact, non-artifactual signal, magnitude about 50 microvolt or 40 microvolt. This is the eye blink artifacted signal, magnitude about 150 microvolt. This is the eye blink artifacted signal, magnitude about 400 microvolt. Now the complete process for removal of detection and removal of the artifact I am narrating here in the graph, in the flowchart. We have the raw EEG, then we are using the people are normally using the classifier at the end or last end part of the second end part of the project of the process. But here we are using in our research the classifier in the stack for classifying the artifactual signal and the non-artifactual signal. This is the new avenue we have opened for classifiers of the researcher. We can work with the classifier in the start or in the end or in the middle. Anywhere we can work with the classifier. So in 2012-13, we have worked on this classifier, ANM 2-class and 3-class problem. And we are trying to minimize the hidden layers. And we are trying to minimize the time for the classification of the artifact and non-artifact detection signal. And after detected the signal, artifacted and non-artifacted, only we are processing the artifactual signal zones for detection of the artifact, and then we are trying to remove those artifacts into the artifacted zone only by the different types of mother wavelet available. We are also studied in this the different types of morphology of the mother wavelet of, for removing the artifact with the wavelet by the wavelet denoising. Now this is the diagram shown here for the machine learning classification for identification of artifact and epoch artifact and the non-artifact of the clean EEG. So in the initial part, we try to collect the data. There are about 70 to 80 page data, 70 to 100 page data is available for 15 minute recording of the EEG. So all the 80 page we have to verify that the signal is artifacted or non-artifacted. So for that we are using very fast classifier like a ANM classifier with the minimized hidden layer. Now here ANM is designed for the 2-class problem. We are supplying here directly, it is unsupervised classification. Here we are supplying the direct data from the different nodes available at the input layer, and after getting the classifier is trained for the number of subjects data, we are getting the in the output layer whether the signal is artifacted or the signal is non-artifacted or the signal is clean. So this is the process we adopted. We make one target table for the artifactual and non-artifactual signal by the visual inspection first, and then we have prepared this table. 01 is for the non-artifactual signal target table value and 10 for the artifactual signal. So this table is supplied to the ANM for training, and ANM will be trained for the detection of non-artifactual signal or the detection of artifactual signal. This is a detailed flow graph or the flow chart for artifactual and non-artifactual EEG signal. It, we have worked with the MATLAB programming instructions and the ANM. Now we could achieve the error below 0.01 for the eye movement artifact and below 0.1 error for the eye blink artifact. And the accuracy level we achieve about 96% for the EB, eye blink, and 97% for eye movement. And now the further we are expanding our ANN classifier for 3-class problem using features. So two of the statistical features we are considering here. One is the variance and another is the mean max of the signal. So these signals are being, features are being supplied to the, first we have taken the various nodes we have created in the ANN, 3-class problem ANN is created here. 3-class is using for the first is for eye blink artifact, second is for the eye movement artifact, and third is for the non-artifact. So this three class ANN classifier is created here, and we could succeed to certain extent to minimize the error than the previous example. So here we got the error below 0.001. Here you can see here up to 10 to the power minus 3. We got the error is about 0.001 from the three class ANN design. So these are the results we got: EEG signal with the eye blink, EEG signal with the eye movement, and this is the non-architectural signal from the. Actually, 100 subject data we have supplied for the training, and about 50 subject data we have supplied for the testing. Sample data I am showing here. The accuracy we are achieving more now, 97 for EB and 98 about for the EM artifact. Now, this is a temporal and spectral analysis of the EEG signal. I am not going very detail of this. This also we done with the signal processing of EEG. This is the normal EEG signal and the its power spectrum. This is the eye blink signal and its power spectrum. Eye movement signal and its power spectrum. We can understand from the power spectrum. Even that is a very good method to understanding the frequency ranges and the power value available in the spectral analysis and the coherence analysis we have done with the all the spectral methodology. This is the combined power spectrum graph for the normal and eye blink and eye movement signal. This is the time frequency analysis for the normal and artifactual signal. This is the non-artifactual signal we have taken of the EEG, and the delta, theta, alpha, and the beta and the gamma signal are separated by the design of a FIR filter. The very crucial FIR filter we have designed here and trying to separate the various rhythms from the EEG for various further work. This is the eye blink artifact signal and its rhythms delta, alpha, beta, and gamma. This is the eye movement artifacted signal, and it has got the various rhythms delta, theta, alpha, beta, and gamma. Again, all these three methodology, three types of signal we have undertaken, and the same FIR signal design methodology for the different frequency bands of the band pass filter we have used in the FIR, and we could clearly separate the all types of rhythms from the all five. Basically, there are number of types of rhythm, but for five basic and the most useful rhythms we have separated from the EEG. This is the new proposed algorithm we have implemented and published in one of the SCI index paper for the artifact detection and then artifact removal. So we have named this algorithm as the time amplitude algorithm. Actually, very simple algorithm we have designed. Nothing more we have done in this algorithm. We could try to collect the zones or areas of the signal which are corrupted by the eye blink and eye movement artifact. So this algorithm we have designed in this way. We have taken the artifactual signal from the after classification of ANN. Then we analyze the signal with the various time and frequency characteristics. The maximum value of the artifact signal generated will be collected in the form of square wave. We have marked it. Then we are creating the edges across the square wave for the artifactual edges, as the artifactual edges and the area or the zone of the artifacted signal in the EEG. And to the artifactual zones only we are applying the artifactual removal. Here we use the ocular artifact have the higher amplitude as below, and no need to transform the signal. That as if suppose we are doing the image processing on the spatial domain on the pixel value itself, the same way on the signal value itself we are doing the detection of artifactual zones. And our algorithm giving the result below the result obtained in many of the authors that we have presented the comparison in one of the SCI index paper. Accuracy is very large. So this is the algorithm we have undertaken. That is the threshold value we have decided first after the very rigorous experimentation. That is EEG maximum into 0.65 we have taken as the threshold value. Then we have scanned this EEG signal with the different zones available, and the one rectangular first is created across the multiple zones having the you can say the artifacts in the EEG, and after creating the rectangular pulse across the artifacted EEG, we mark those rectangular zones by this equation, and after marking this zones by this equation, we collect this data in the memory of the system or in the system as a artifactual zone of the EEG, and to those artifactual zone only we are applying the removal system or removal algorithm. So this is the result. I am showing you sample results of the FP1 channel. This is the artifactual zone we have marked our algorithm by our algorithm. This is the artifactual zones in the eye movement artifact. This is the another sample I have shown for zone marking in the artifactual EEG for the various electrodes available. Normally in the front polar and one of the central and the temporal region, we have the artifactual zone more of the eye blink and eye movement artifact. I am not going very theoretical way of the system we have implemented. Just the summary of this I will tell you. We have used here the discrete wavelet transform and the stationary wavelet transform. We have trying to tune the modified Otsu thresholding algorithm or as a thresholding algorithm for the removal signal or for removing the artifact from the signal. And the modified Otsu technique is useful to find out the threshold, which is minimizing the intra-class and the intra-class variance, or the it will maximize the between-class variance. So through the Otsu thresholding, we are designing the system in such a way that we could retain the all cerebral signal, all the you can say original EEG signal, and we can remove the artifact from the EEG signal. So this is the process we have adapted through the flowchart. It is explained here. Already I have told you in the words. Then these are the results we got as the artifactual removal using mother wavelet debauches 4 of the various electrodes. Then this is by the simulate 3 using stationary wavelet transform. This is by debauchy 5 mother wavelet using DWT for the channel C4 for the eye movement artifact. And these are the results we got for the C4, CF8, P3 and the T4 channel of the EEG using stationary wavelet transform with the simulate 3 mother wavelet. Then performance matrix of the removal we have done. So we use these three parameters: normalized mean square, normalized absolute error, and the fuzzy entropy. These three equations and the programming implementation in MATLAB we have done. So we got the results very promising. Using MSE, we got the results C in the right side table. For the simulate 3 stationary wavelet transform, we got the promising result. Error is less than about 0.09, 0.03. Sometimes we got 0.1, 0.1, 0.1, like that. So result we got here, promising. Actually, we have to work out more for the error will be minimization or error minimization. But we are trying to work now. Even now we are working on the artifact removal with the as small as possible error. This is the table for normalized mean absolute error. Here also for the same type of wavelet we got the results promising. Then we have worked on the fuzzy entropy. This is the new type of entropy developed before 5 years by one of the organization and the team. So this is we are used to describe the nonlinearity in the brain. So a fuzzy entropy will be more for the artifactual signal, and fuzzy entropy will be lesser for the artifactual signal, and fuzzy entropy will be more for non-artifactual signal, because the nonlinearity will be retained in the signal if the signal will be non-artifacted. This is the table for eye movement type of artifact, and previous was the table for eye blink. So discussion and conclusion for this part, actually the discussion is not over. This is the discussion and conclusion for this eye blink and eye movement artifactual part. Ocular artifacts, as we know, that are more prominent artifact in the EEG. It is proposed to have the faithful detection and removal artifact removal algorithm along with the techniques without losing the cerebral information of the original EEG. ANM with the 2-class and 3-class problem is failed for the both the types of artifact and non-artifactual signal. Using ANN and DWT and SWT, we could succeed to certain extent to minimizing the error of the minimizing the artifact from the PEG. And as a performance matrix, we got the promising result and appreciated these results in the one of the SCI index paper published in Signal Image Video from the Springer in 2015. Gulane sir, I am very clearly audible.
Sir, audible, sir.
So, I am taking 15-20 minutes more for the different modalities of the image.
Yes, sir. Sure, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. So now, briefly, I am explaining the medical imaging technologies and different modalities and their use for the diagnosis and treatment planning, as well for the future development. As we all aware, the medical imaging is the procedure used to attain the image of the body parts from the medical images to identify or to study the diseases. The medical imaging is developing rapidly due to development in image processing techniques, including image analysis, image enhancement, image segmentation, image communication, and image recognition. These are the various techniques undertaken in the image processing. The various image modalities are widely used in the biomedical field. Those are ultrasound imaging, X-ray imaging, computed tomography, then MR, CT, angiographies, MRI, functional MRI. Even I have not listed here the gold MRI and the different types of MRI we have. No doubt, all these MRIs we have with the different types of magnetism with the machine we have. But normally, functional MRI and MRI is more useful, right? And the different protocols are also available for different organs. These are also very important, along with the modalities of the image in the medical image processing. Along with the MRI, blood oxygen level dependent MRI, we got the PET, SPECT. These are also the, you can say, nuclear medicine modalities available with us in the medical image processing. Now, existing hybrid imaging modalities, PET CT, SPECT CT, MRI PET, MRI SPECT, ultrasound and MRI, ultrasound and CT, and MRI and CT. So these are the various hybrid imaging modalities are available nowadays. And the various types of say disease can be more understandable with this, you can say, hybrid type of modalities, or you can say fusion of two modalities or fusion of two imaging system. The general benefits of the hybrid imaging modalities includes increasing diagnostic accuracy, further step towards the individual medicine. It is precisely monitoring the interventional procedures for treatment planning and everything. It is reduced the radiation exposure, that is example dynamic use sonography or getting from the CT. The more exposure we are, radiations we are getting from the CT and the X-ray. So MRI, what is MRI? Last session from the last week, MRI was discussed in detail. I am not going very detail of the MRI. It is the physics of MRI. I am narrated here with the steps. MRI is the radiology technique, which is based on the principle of nuclear magnetic resonance imaging. MRI makes use the magnetic properties of the certain atomic nuclei, hydrogen nucleus, single proton present in the water molecule, and therefore the all body tissue will be useful for grabbing the MRI images. Basically, MRI, CT, and most of the imaging technology is the image reconstruction technology, or image reconstruction imaging type is this. The nuclei can be rotated using the radio frequency wave. As we all aware, the radio frequency is required for 1 Tesla. I think 42.57 megahertz radio frequency wave per Tesla is being used in the MRI machine. Simultaneously, they emit the radio signals, and the photons are being perturbed and then will be aligned towards the alignment. And remaining coils, XYZ coils are there. The gradient of the magnetism or magnetic field will be collected, and then the signal will be formed in terms of the sine wave, and then the sine space will be, or the k space will be formed in the MRI system, and the k space will be converted into image space, and the image is reconstructed from the MRI. This is the recording system of the, or the physics of the MRI. MRI will give us the detailed image, very detailed image can be from the soft tissues. Soft tissue image will be very detailed through the MRI technology. This is the simple diagram I have shown for the MRI scanner system available. We got the XYZ three magnets inside that. Radio frequency pulse will be, coil is applied to the regular frequency, and the patient is inside the gantry is available. The machine will be grabbing the signal through the protocols. What can be diagnosed by the MRI? Most of the element of the brains and the including tumors, the disease can be diagnosed by the MRI. Sport injuries, musculoskeletal problems, spinal conditions, vascular abnormalities, female pelvic problems, prostate problems, some gastrointestinal problems, damage associated with the epilepsy, certain ear nose system damages can be grabbed by the MRI, and soft tissue and the bone pathology conditions can be grabbed easily by the MRI. Here I have listed the types of brain disorders. Some of the disorders already known to all of us, but some are new to us. And you can just read out, or we can read out dementia, Alzheimer's, the part of the dementia and all has been already discussed with many of the speakers. I'm not going detail of this, all the types of disorders, but just listing the brain disorders here. Meningitis. Then who cannot do the MRI? The cardiac pacemaker implanted person cannot do the MRI. Certain clips in the head, a cochlear implant, metallic foreign body in the eye of the body, surgery in the last 8 weeks, and the pregnant woman cannot do the MRI. What are advantages of MRI? No ionizing radiation. Variable thickness is in any plane. Better contrast resolution. And many details without intravenous contrast are available with the MRI. This is the MRI imaging system as a laboratory available in the with the radiologist. The room is isolated because very high magnetic field is available inside, about 1.5 Tesla, 2 Tesla. In the USA or in the Germany, they are using about 7 to 9 Tesla machines for research nowadays. 7 to 9 Tesla machines are being used in the USA and Germany and the Japan in the MRI machines for research purpose. So this is the gantry system, and the radiologist is counseling to the subject. So for claustrophobia may be available to the subject. So this radiologist must be counseled to the subject for some may have the claustrophobia or the dirt or the fear of the going into the gantry. So radiologists normally are doing the counseling to the subject or the patient for the MRI scan. 15-20 minutes are required to scan the organ or the part of the MRI you want to take. And this is the control room available. On the screen directly we can see the images available from the MRI. Not many processes are involved in that. I am not going very detail of that. The functional MRI, little bit I am narrating here about the functional MRI. It was developed in 90s. It is based on the same technology of the MRI. fMRI looks at the blood flow and the perfusions of the perfusions in the arteries and the veins of the human organ. It is technique for measuring the brain activity. It works by detecting the changes in the blood oxygenation and flow that occur in the response to the neural activity. These are the basic difference between the MRI and the fMRI. So fMRI views the metabolic function, it calculates the oxygen levels, long distance resolution, it is utilizing for diagnostic and the therapeutic guidance purposes. This is the example I have collected from one of the paper. Wherein in the MRI we are not getting so much clarity about the disease. In fMRI we are getting the clarity of the disease available with this axial size of MRI. Basically there are three types of slice we can collect it from the MRI system. First type is axial, Second type is coronal, and third type is the sagittal. So suppose this is the brain available. So from first left to right, lateral to lateral, we can collect the sagittal slice. Cross section like this, we can collect the say axial slice, and from front to anterior to posterior, we can collect the coronal slice from the MRI. Nowadays in the machine, we are trying to incorporate the softwares for volumetric information from the slice of MRIs. So this is very useful nowadays to see the 3D views of the different organs or the sectional views of the organs of the bodies available of the human beings available. Now this is the example I have collected one paper. Here the MRI reveals the striking brain differences in people with the genetic autism. So here the corpus callosum is become thickened. Here the corpus callosum becomes thin. Here the enlarged verticals are there. Here the dense and craniocervical abnormalities are available at this point. So these are all the points I have shown here on this graph. It is collected from one of the research paper. It's also collected from one of the research paper, transient lesion in the spinium of corpus callosum. This is the case in the epileptic. Here you can see this is dilated. This part of the brain is, it is the corpus callosum, dilated one, and it can be seen in the axial view here. You can see. This axial view, this is the sagittal view of the sagittal plane of the MRI. Sagittal, we get this dilation part, and in the axial part, we get here like this. So this is the one of the disease we have detected in the MRI by the 2-3 views of the slices. Now the second and third modality is X-ray and the CT scan. Basically, X-ray discovers or invented X-ray and CT scan presented the major advantage in the medicines. As you all aware, very old modalities in the medical image processing or medical imaging is the X-ray. It is developed in the end of 19th century. X-ray diagnostic radiology is the generated by the interaction of X-rays, photon, and which have transmitted the patient body to the patient body organ or patient body, and towards reverse side, the photon detector will be there. Detector will be collected the signal. Radiological signal will be collected in the form of photon energy, and that will be converted into the image. So CT, radiography, mammography, fluoroscopy, all these are the same, working on the same principle of X-ray. So this is the CT in the COVID-19. The severe pneumonia of the subject is available here. In the two lungs, you can see here. These are the glassy structure available of the alveoli and all in the lung structure of the one of the subject. This is a normal bone structure of the human hand. This is the process under the CT machine. We have the different types of CT machine, CT imaging technologies available now in the one CT machine. Then we have the cone CT, spider CT, whole body CT, or the helical CT. Different types of CT protocols and the CT scanning techniques are available with the CT machine nowadays. So I am not going very detail of this scanning and all. Just for your information, I am giving. What for the CT scan will we do? It will detect the bone and joint parts like complex bone fractures and the tumors. It is also used for cancer detection, heart disease, emphysema, liver diseases, liver masses. CT scan for the spot it to just have the extent and the spot of the disease, then help the doctors to see the changes. It also can be used for internal injuries, bleeding, causes of the by the accidents. It helps to locate the tumors, blood clot, and the excess blood fluid and the infections. It is also useful for guided treatment plans and the procedures for the biopsy, surgery, and the radiation therapy. It is comparing to find out the certain treatment which are working for the subjects. For example, scan of the tumor over the time, it can show the whether it is responding to the chemotherapy or the radiation to the subject. Now this is the system for X-ray scanning. One of the system, it is portable one. We can move anywhere and take the real X-ray of the object. Here the right-hand object X-ray is being obtained. This is the system wherein we can see directly. Nowadays we have the digital X-ray. Previously we have to grab the X-ray on the film. Now we are directly recording the signal on the screen, or we can do the signals on the screen. So here you can see the radiology of the X-ray signals are available on the screen. That means the time is now saved of the subject and the radiologist, that they can, within the 5-10 minutes, they can relieve to the patient that their X-ray is okay or not, and they can give the treatment. This is again the CT machine. I am showing here sample CT machine. Actually, the GE, General Electric Corporation, Siemens, Philips, then many more companies are available for making this CT scan, MRI, fluoroscopy, mammogram machines, and the sonography machines also. Now this is the mammogram of a breast, wherein by the signal processing technology or image processing technology, the negative image will show the clear calcification in the mammogram. Now this is the another CT scan I have shown in axial view. Therein Alzheimer's disease is shown. Enlarged of cerebral sulci will be there. Sulcus and gyrus are there always. The dilation of ventricle part is shown here, and the loss of gyral volume is shown. So three types of understanding is there with this, and they could understand the level of Alzheimer's the subject have. The common side effects by the CT scan will be flushing, rashes, itching, runny nose, coughing, dizziness, abdominal cramps, constipation, nausea, and vomiting. These are the common side effects of the CT scan. These are the image collected from the good research papers. This is the CT scan for the acute stroke. You can see here the change in the morphology as well as change in the tones of the different types of organs available with this. This is the ischemic stroke detected here in the axial view. Atrophy is detected along with the ischemic stroke. There are two spots of the atrophy, and extent has been detected by the CT. And this is the hemorrhage stroke detected by the CT. Now next type of modalities is the sonograph. It is based on the sound wave, acoustic wave, and the frequency is greater than 20 kilohertz. So diagnostic imaging is generally performed using ultrasonography by the frequency range 2 to 15 megahertz. The choice of frequencies is detected by a trade-off between the spatial resolution and the penetration or depth of the sound wave signal with the particular disease. With the particular subject and the disease required to detect. Normally, non-bony part of the human being organs are detected very popularly by the ultrasonograph. Non-bony part, like the our stomach part is the non-bony part in our body. So non-bony parts will be detected very clearly by the sectional view. Basically, ultrasonography is the sectional view of the organ. So sectional view of the organ will be collected by collecting the propagation, reflection, and attenuation of the sound waves from the tissue to the ultrasonography. Ultrasonography measures the reflectivity of the tissue through the sound waves. It can also measure the velocity of the moving objects, that is blood flow, through the Doppler, color Doppler technology of the ultrasonography. This is also one of the older. It was developed in the, I think, 1970s, and it is having the 50 years history now. So it has been developed properly now till date, I think. They are still developing the machines, but the color Doppler imaging through ESD technologies is nowadays very popular for the blood flow measurement and the different types of clotted in the blood veins, blood in the veins by of the various organs in the body. Normally, it is very much useful for the non-bony part. Now you can see this is the example I have given here of the pregnant woman. The sonologist is taking the sonography, and you can see here the nose of the fetus, head of the fetus, and the spine of the fetus in the ultrasonography. They will judge the various conditions. And these are the striking features of the sonograph. It is low cost, inexpensive, having very low radiations, exposure, non-invasive method, safe method, fast imaging method, portability of the system is available, non-ionizing nature of the ultrasound, the ability to process or to produce the real-time images of blood flow and moving structures as well in the heart beating system can be done by the sonograph. The intrinsic contrast among the soft tissue structure that is achieved without the need of injected contrast in the intravenous way of the subject or the patient. These are the wide range of application under the sonography. You can use for the vascular imaging, cardiac imaging. Abdominal part is very much useful for the sonography, various diseases under the kidney, under the liver, under the pancreas, under the spleen, under the uterus system. Under utero or in utero imaging is also available nowadays for the fetus for disease diagnosis of the women nowadays. The under uterus imaging is also available with the sonography with the different types of tests. Doppler imaging, already told you, cancer imaging sometimes detected, but cancer imaging will be more useful. Cancer imaging will be very prominently detected by the MR, CT, SPECT and PET. These are the various sound speeds available for the various substances or the material in the body. Now see, these are the sample images I have collected from some research papers and the websites. Abdominal wall, this is the perichlorocytis fat is available. Gallbladder's is wall is thickened here. This is the liver and gallbladder. Bile, this is the slot and gallstones have been observed in the gallbladder by the sonograph. Acoustic shadowing is shown here. Yes, you can see here. This is the acoustic shadowing. So this is the liver and gallbladder sectional view of from the sonograph. Here also I have shown the gallbladder wall, liver, hyperchoic gallstones with the posterior shadowing is there in this particular image. And you can see the polymite lesion of the gallbladder is shown in this sonographic image. This is the anterior wall lumen, posterior wall is the fatty wrapping, Oscus muscle will be there. And this is the ultrasound in Crohn's disease, bowel wall characteristics and perfusion instrument using the micro bubbles. This is the bowel structure available here in the sonograph. This is the intraluminal air is shown, thickness of the bowel wall is shown and dirty shadow is shown in the sonography for the Crohn's disease for the bowel obstruction. These are the image, I have not worked on this image, I have collected image for your understanding or for discussion. Now the PET imaging, I am not going very detail of the physics of the PET imaging. This is one of the you can say nuclear imaging modalities is available, and it is using the basics of the PET imaging technique, detects the pair of gamma rays is emitted indirectly by the positron emission radionuclides, and the tracer is injected into the vein on the biological active molecules, usually a sugar, that FBG is used for this tracer or the dye will be given to the intravenous system. And the PET system has the sensitive detector panel to capture the gamma rays emission from the inside the bodies, and the signals are being collected in the form of tomographic images. Why the PET scan? PET scan can be inspected blood flow, oxygen intake, metabolism, organ tissues. PET scan also show the problem of cellular level, giving doctors or the physician to the best view of the complex systematic diseases. PET scan are mostly used for detect the cancer, heart problem, brain disorders like the nervous system disorders, Alzheimer, depression, epilepsy, head trauma and the Parkinson's. This is the system of PET scanner, machine is available. This is the normal activity of the liver, low activity of the hematoma, high activity of the metastatic cancer, stomach and the spleen. This is the image I have collected from one of the paper. This is the brain metabolic abnormalities shown associated with the developmental venous anomalies. So no abnormal metabolism detected in the first. In the moderate, hypometabolism is there. Here the severe hypometabolism is seen here. The ventricle part and the, in this image you can see clearly in the PET image. This is the mild hypometabolism seen in this. These are the images collected from the good papers. Now the last type of modalities I want to discuss, that is the SPECT image overview. This is the physics of the SPECT I am explaining with the diagram. The single photon emission computed tomography, it is scanning the image from the human body organ, and the physician lets analyze the function of internal organs. So radioactive tracer is inserted through the intravenous injection to the patient subject, and tracer circulate the throughout the body to its half life time. Normally suppose the lifetime is half hour, 15 minutes are required to circulate this, and just after 15 minutes the image is being taken through the gamma camera collection, or the it is the subject is being lie between the gamma table and the gamma cameras rotated around the body, and the camera creates the 3D images and 2D images of the organs and the tissues from the body. This is the physics, or you can say methodology, for the SPECT imaging technique. Single photon emission computed tomography, scanning the images to test the blood flow, diagnose the seizure, stroke, fracture, infection, etc. For the brain disorder, it will be useful for dementia, clot, blood vessels, seizure, epilepsy, head injuries, etc. The SPECT image scanning system is this, and under this machine, the subject is being placed like this. The heart problem, it can be used for heart problem, it can be used for reduced pumping efficiency, and the bone disorders. These are the images collected from good paper. Traumatic brain injuries will be there. Accidental brain injuries will be there detected in the. This is the image. Actually, this is the fusion of the image we can do here by the SPECT and the MR, or SPECT and the CT. Here the MR SPECT fusion will be done, and the examination of the probe band is there. The MRI reveals the marked cortical and subcortical atrophy between the both occipital and the parietal part. So this is the occipital part. This is the basically coronal type, axial type, and the axial type images and SPECT images collected together. And SPECT demonstrated here the severe hyperperfusion within the parietal and the occipital and the temporal region of the brain. So this is the basically MRI and SPECT modalities used together for understanding the disease. See, I am not master of this disease and the master of the imaging, but I am trying to show you the modalities available in brief. These are the various SPECT brain imaging as a potential specific diagnosis of the metastatic brain tumors and the high grade gliomas. So here the SPECT MR images are collected, and this is the combined fusion images available. You can see the results are more prominent in the fusion of the image of SPECT and MR. These are the SPECT imaging of for epilepsy, and is the overview of the PET comparison with the fluorodeoxyglucose will be inserted to the diet in the subject, and you can understand here the MRI SPECT fusion, understand the proper location and the extent of disease under the brain. But this is the MRI. Here you cannot see very clear in the MRI, but in the SPECT we are looking more clear of the particular disease. And the fusion of the image by the MRI and the SPECT is being done here. MR SPECT fusion is this, and we are getting more clear disease available here for the epilepsy. Concluding remarks for this imaging modalities from my side is, the future investigation in comparing the performance of most of the advanced algorithms and the methods using the fusion of multiple modalities of the images and the one-dimensional electrophysiological signals with the functional imaging is possible. The image processing increases the percentage and amount of detected tissues under the image is being considered. The interaction between the extracted information obtained from the multiple signals and the modalities seems to be very useful and promising for the various types of disease detection, therapeutic guidance, disease manipulation or disease treatment planning, and the various types of machine guided surgery also it is used. This slide is showing for the online database available for the various image modalities and the signal modalities. I suggest my personal view, you should have the contact with neurophysician or the various physicians for the disease you want to study, or you want to study in the image and signal processing, and collect the data, annotate data from the neurophysician or the physician or the radiologist. So if you have the annotated data or the marked data or the guided data, you can do the supervised, unsupervised both type of classification, disease detection and understanding and the guidance. So these are the websites and the various types of links are available here. I am collecting for you. You can take the snapshot of this, no problem. And if you are working on the annotated data, from this database, we don't have the annotated data in some database. We don't know the data is for what, actually data is given. So if you have the annotated data and the data is known data or the visual inspected data by the physician, so if such type of data you'll be getting, we can work more and we can understand more our working or our research or our technology. So here one of the link is given for the ethical clearance. For my project, I have obtained ethical clearance from the Government College, Medical College, Akola. I have worked on this particular topic, detection and localization of epilepsy from the EEG, along with the artifact detection and removal as a clinical biomarker. And I have collected for this technique about 500 subject data throughout the 5 years in my research. And I could succeed in good amount of research, which will be need-based research for the physician. And my research can be incorporated in the machine in terms of hardware and software. So this is about the ethical clearance. These are the references I have used, along with the list I will show you. I think my list is visible to all of you, I believe. These are the references list for all these slides I have shown you. About 65 references I have visited, I have collected. This is the last slogan for all of us, written by great Sant. No matter how educated, how talented, how rich and cool you believe you are, how you treat to the people ultimately tell us. Integrity is everything. Even the small puppy will be served by the small boy or the kid. Right? Yeah, you can see. This is the slogan for all of us. Yes, it is my habit to give the slogan at the end. That's why I'm giving. And thank you all. Thank you very much. It is over from my side. Thank you, sir. It is over from my side. I'll be happy to answer your questions. I think I took more than 1.5 hours.
Yes, sir. Any question from audience?
I'll be happy to answer.
Due to some emergency, principal sir is not available with us.
Okay, no problem.
Okay. No, any question from audience?
I'll be happy to answer the questions.
Very informative talk, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, madam.
Lots of details about the way the data has been captured is discussed.
Yeah.
And the processing part. Very good.
Thank you, ma'am.
Singh sir, you were about to mention something. Singh sir, aap kuch kehne wale the.
No, I was no questions. I was only wanting to appreciate that the way he has gone into details of all the techniques today which are available for investigation, and what is the science behind it, and what is the technology behind it, and how it is done, and then to the merging of that and analysis of data and other things. So I can only say that what Mahesh has presented is not only a, from the engineering point of view or technology point of view, it is also the doctor's views also.
Yeah.
You have definitely done it in two, combination of two, both of them.
Yeah.
Your skill set basically lies in the domain of both as engineering and also of the medical science.
I work with the physician also.
Yeah, that's a total 100%. So it is so good, I can tell you that.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Very, very, very informative and very so-called, you know.
Thank you for your compliment, sir.
It really reveals the, your what experience you have and what type of work you have done it.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for such a nice exposure to this subject.
Thank you very much, sir, for your compliments. And your Ashirwad is there.
Yes.
Any more questions from audience?
I think principal sir is available. Gulani sir is available.
No, sir is not available with us.
No, he is available, I think, now.
No, I have joined from his account.
He is digesting what you have told already.
Okay. Okay, sir, thank you.
Okay, so here I am assuming there is no question from audience. So thank you very much, sir.
Because the presentation has above questions.
I am trying to cover every aspect of the
model. Nice. So neatly you have done it, so nicely you have done it.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you very much, everyone, sir, for your knowledge informative session. I am sure it will benefit all the attendees. There is important notice for all the participants. Please note that the certificate for participation can be obtained online. All participants are hereby requested to fill the feedback form for generation of participation certificate. The feedback link is already shared in chat box. So now I request Mrs. KT Bhandwalkar to give vote of thanks. Thank you so much. I take this opportunity to express my sincere thanks to Dr. Manish Hidewa sir, Dr. Mamta Padore ma'am. We are thankful to all the principals, faculty, corporate and students and all the members for attending the program. Last but not least, we are thankful to IIT and our management who is always supportive for the organizing such events. With the kind permission of the chief guest, I declare the program is over and pray for everyone's good health. Thank you very much for everyone.
Can I leave, madam? Can I leave?
Yes, thank you so much, everybody.
Thank you all.
Very useful and knowledgeable contents are there. You have worked exhaustively all aspects into the topic.
And thank you, sir.
We are very close to us, but we are not knowing it. But now I will be making use of you.
Definitely, sir. You are always welcome. You are my brother. No problem.
Yes, the most important thing here will be when you now go to doctor, you know what is being done on you and whether that is or not.
Yeah.
Taken for a ride.
In fact, my
if you have this information, really.
My daughter is becoming doctor.
You cannot be taken for the ride. Or you do this test, you do this test, you do this test.
Sir, in fact, my daughter is becoming doctor in Government Medical College.
Very nice.
Sir, Tibdewal sir, one of my sister is already a radiologist.
Okay.
So I will work now with you because the combination is available with me.
I will be happy to meet her, sir.
Yes, definitely we will work out.
Where she is, sir?
She is at Nagpur. She is having her own hospital. Husband and wife, both are doctors.
I have been in contact with the SIMS Nagpur and the Akola since long back. Even I have been contacted to Leelavati Hospital and the Government Medical College, Calcutta.
Okay.
Now I will extend my contacts for different.
Definitely.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you all. For giving me the opportunity,
Dr. Manish, I feel that you should make a small booklet for this.
Yeah,
any small type of thing, and which people can use it.
Yeah, Yeah, definitely, sir.
A small manual type of thing.
With your all blessing, I will do
it. It will be published, and it will be a very good document with all the people can put, you know, ready reckoned type of thing. Because the amount of work you have done in that amount of exposure you have given it, I mean, it's impossible to retain in the mind, and not anybody can make a note. But each family having such a thing as a document with them, a good type of reference book or reference this one, it will be really very helpful. Very, very helpful.
Definitely. So definitely, sir.
I feel that you should just bring out a small booklet type of thing. Small business.
And definitely.
Yes.
With the all blessing, I will do it, sir.
Oh, nice. It will be very nice.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, everyone.
Maybe the last lectures and the coming lecture, which is coming, Madam, you hosted today, some input from there and from this one, and plus yours can be combined. All three can be, mother, it can be a joint writing also.
Sir, we will do that. Tibrewal, sir, it will be more than welcome.
Mamtaji, you have also done so this one.
Yes, sir. Definitely, I
will. Thank you, sir.
I will contact to the persons and community will be developed.
Yes.
Yes. During my research work, I had contacted Anand Agriculture University to study about how the DNA sequencing is done. That time, way back in 2007-8-9, there were only two DNA sequencing machines in India.
Yeah.
And that costed 4 crore rupees. So, so I got an opportunity to observe the DNA sequencing process and work on the supercomputer that was attached to the sequencer.
Yes, nice.
Yeah, so that was good. And
no, all the input coming from all three of you, I think it will really do a very good, it will very good reference book.
Yes, sir.
We'll do. Yeah, we'll try. Thank you, sir. We need your blessings. Yeah, thank you so much. Yeah,
blessings are all with you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, yeah.
Shall I leave, madam? Shall I leave?
Yes, yes. We all leave. Thank you so much. Bye. Namaste, sir.
Yes, bye.
Thank you.